Some late night action here after a full slate of Tuesday college football. This is the Guaranteed Rate Bowl, Chase Field, Phoenix, Arizona, 10:15 Eastern kickoff here, Ralph. We get West Virginia and Minnesota, Big 12 versus Big 10 action, -4 to -5, depending where you're shopping. That is Minnesota in this one, 45 being the total. I don't know. Is this some few too many points here? I was looking towards the Mountaineers. How are you looking at this one, Ralph?
Well, you know, you're going to hear this a lot on the show, and you're going to hear this a lot on every bowl game we go over. You know, this is a game I would have played if Letty Brown was going to line up as the running back of West Virginia. You know, over 1,000 yards, almost 5 yards per carry. Garrett Dagey is much different when he doesn't have that rush attack. You know, the West Virginia team, to me, was a team that improved down the stretch. Yes, they lost to Oklahoma State, which wasn't a bad loss, and they lost to Kansas State, but in that loss, they actually had a 345 to 299-yard edge. They were -3 turnovers. Again, when Dagey's forced the pass, that scares me. The Minnesota defense, #4 in the country, legit. Of course, they had Ibrahim, one of the top running backs in the country, not only in the Big Ten, get hurt early in the year against Ohio State. And the rush attack just not the same at 4.2 yards per carry. P.J. Fleck has lost 10 games as a straight-up favorite. And this year of Minnesota's 12 games, 6 have been upsets. They've pulled an upset win in 4 games. They lost as the favorite in 2 games. As I said, I liked West Virginia. Now, while West Virginia is 1-10 their last 11 in bowl games, so much of the bowl games are based on head coaches, and I do put a great deal of importance on head coaches and what their record is. Neil Brown, now 4-0 straight up as a bowl coach. P.J. Fleck, 2-0, winning 2 games as a dog. He was a 5.5-point dog and won by 24 points, and he was a 7-point dog and won by a touchdown. But here's the difference. When P.J. Fleck came to Minnesota, Minnesota was not a good program. It was row the boat, let's buy in, let's become a winning program. This year, the way they started with the loss to Ohio State and then that upset loss to Bowling Green, they were thinking they were going to be in a bigger bowl than they are. West Virginia, where they are, yeah, perhaps they had higher expectations, but I think overall the West Virginia fans are more excited to be here. Lean with West Virginia for me. Again, this is an opt-out that cost me a play because with Letty Brown in the lineup, I would have been on West Virginia.
Good stuff, Ralph. And Robbie, coming to you next. You know, Ralph brings up a good point. You know, head coaches in bowl games, how they performed in the past, something I like to look at as well. We get two young, I guess you could say up-and-coming head coaches, at least from where they came from, you know, from the MAC and from the Sun Belt. Now they're finding themselves in the making a little bit more money, I guess we could say, and coaching very well in bowl season. We remember some of those Troy years with Troy Brown there, Robbie. I know you were on some of those. And then like Minnesota, those wins as dogs, like Ralph talked about, one of them was against Auburn. They looked really good in bowl season. So it's kind of a wash there, both towards the positive with both of these two head coaches. How are you feeling here? Row the boat, or you think the dog is barking?
I think I feel row the boat, Drew. first of all, the line at -4.5 right now as we speak. My power ratings only made Minnesota 2.5. You're going to see a lot of that. Ralph talked about us seeing a lot of, you know, conditionary plays that are ruined because of opt-outs. you'll see a lot of price tags in bowl games that are either inflated, deflated, whatever the case, whether you're on the favorite or the dog. This one may be a little bit inflated. Letty Brown's a big loss. Obviously, the onus of the running game falls upon Tony Mathis Jr., now a sophomore, 59 carries, 256 yards, 4.3 a carry. Hasn't cracked the end zone yet this year, but, you know, Letty Brown, almost 4 times as much of that. And it really the linchpin of that offense. But here's like the hidden angle that I want to bring up that may point toward Minnesota, and we'll see how this works out. Kirk Ciarrocca was just rehired by Minnesota as their offensive coordinator. He spent this entire 2021 season as an offensive analyst for West Virginia. So Minnesota has a guy who's been in West Virginia's camp all season long, knows the play calling, knows the tendencies, knows everything. Does that help Minnesota here? I mean, you got a guy right on your sidelines who can tell you, or at least up in a booth or somewhere that could tell you, or during the 15 practices, that can show you what West Virginia does. Does West Virginia go out now and scramble everything up during their 15 practices, or do they just play it the same? Either way, I think having Kirk Shiraka is a huge advantage here for Minnesota. Again, a guy who's very, very familiar with what West Virginia has done this season offensively. He also comes back to Minnesota. He was here under PJ Fleck 2017 to 19, then took a job at Penn State as the offensive coordinator in 20, the COVID year. He worked under Fleck at Western Michigan. So the relationship here is really, really good between these two. He's now back. Fundamentally in this game, Minnesota's an unbalanced offensive play calling club, right? They just lean on the run, on the run, on the run. Their play calling percentages this year, guys, 69.3% run plays, only 30.7 to the pass. The yardage doesn't necessarily get tipped that heavily on the scales here. I mean, 54% of their yardage came running, 46 passing, but Minnesota doesn't really run it to break off, you know, 30, 40 yard runs. They run it just to pound and pound and pound and, you know, move some sticks. They've averaged 4.2 a carry, as Ralph said, since Ibrahim went down. Going to run a couple of numbers here for you. The West Virginia run defense, when you look at it overall, looks really good. The numbers are pretty good. I think they only allow like 129 a game on the ground. In five games this year, let me give you four. Texas and Iowa State both gained over 200 yards against this defense. They both went for over seven a carry. Baylor gained 171 yards rushing against this defense, 5.3 a carry. K-State, 161, 4.0 a carry. TCU got 4.4 per carry against this defense. The only reason why I bring up these games where West Virginia allowed more than 4 yards per rush is because on the season, when Minnesota does that, when they gain 4.0 yards per carry or more, 5-2 straight up, 5-1-1 against the spread. If they go over 4.0 yards a carry, then they become a 5-1 straight up team and a 5-0-1 ATS team. So West Virginia's allowed it to good rushing teams. If Minnesota gets it, they probably win this game. West Virginia on the other side, dependent upon pass yardage. If you look at their play calling and even their yardage, they only gained 37% of their yards on the ground. As good as Letty Brown was, wasn't exactly bringing them to any great offensive accomplishments this year. Ralph talked about Minnesota's overall defense. The pass defense has been great. Seventh in the nation in completion percentage, ninth in the nation in pass yardage allowed. They've played five pass offenses that rank better than West Virginia, so they should be able to handle this. Last thing I come to in this game is, do I want Jarrett Daigie or do I want Tanner Morgan? They're kind of the same quarterback, but I think I'd rather have Morgan. He's more dependable as far as hanging on to the football goes. So for me, I just think Minnesota's OL is going to pound, pound, pound on West Virginia. I don't know that West Virginia is going to get a lot done offensively. I'll take the motivational aspects of PJ Fleck here and lay the 4.5.
Okay. Would you take PJ Fleck or Troy Brown, Rob Vino, the coach you'd want to bet on more?
At this point in time, I'd probably say PJ Fleck over Neil Brown, simply because in Power 5 action, Fleck's been a little more successful at this point.
Okay.
With a middle of the Big Ten program, much like Neil Brown got a middle of the Big 12 program at West Virginia. So I'd probably say Fleck right now.
Yeah, I called him Troy Brown. Neil Brown. Hey, Ralph, anything quickly, which coach you would rather bet on?
Well, you know, I will say this. I'm indifferent on which one. Neil Brown is 7-0 against the spread against winning non-conference FBS foes. So, you know, he has stepped up when he's needed to. Yeah, Minnesota's obviously in a better position. I think they're in a better recruiting position than West Virginia in the Big 12. So that to me gives, you know, PJ Fleck a little bit of an edge, not because he's the better coach, but he's in the better situation.
Interesting. Yeah, the situation always mattering with recruiting going forward. Although Morgantown's a pretty fun time, I've heard. So we'll see how that goes in the years to come.